Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you all here for our all-age service of the 8th of August. Also welcome if you're watching at home. We were just a little bit delayed because one of the projectors decided to stop shining, I think. I'm not quite sure if it's the bulb or something else, but we still have one screen if you're inside, so sorry for the crooked necks, but you'll just have to watch that one. We're going to begin by singing Jubilate, Everybody, and that will be sung through twice. So as if you've been before, then you know the routine. We'll stand to sing. You do have to keep your mask on, so moderate your breathing and enjoy it. So Jubilate, Everybody, hymn 65. God, we come to you at the start of this service in your presence with gratitude and with praise. We are glad we can be together in ever more normal circumstances, and we can sit a bit closer, and it doesn't look quite as strange when we are gathered. We're grateful for all the changes and the improvements that have been made in dealing with the pandemic. We know many people are still, or families are away on holiday, and we'll hopefully see them back in a few weeks. We will enjoy this last week of the school holidays for those who that applies to, and look forward to the normal routines of school starting up again. We thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness, and we need to remind ourselves that you've created each one of us, and you've created us uniquely with the gifts and the talents and our own personal quirks. And nobody's perfect because we're only human, but you've made us to praise you and to worship you and to live our lives in honor of you in our own unique way. So help us to remember that. And forgive us for the times where we have been jealous of other people, what they have, or what they're like, or what they look like, and felt that we're not good enough. Help us to only focus our minds on you and what you want for our lives, and to know that you accept us with grace and love, and you have an image for us that is achievable and that will fulfill us. Only you are God, and only you are our creator. So please forgive us for our sins and help us to have a right mindset. We pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. today we're going to hear, or rather see, of Paul and Barnabas. A few weeks ago we heard of Paul's conversion from being someone who was persecuting the early Christians in Jerusalem and across that area, to be meeting Jesus and being stopped in his tracks and then becoming Jesus' apostle. And this week we hear, some time has passed now, and he's been speaking to the people in Jerusalem and further afield and talking about Jesus and his death and resurrection, and that he's Lord over all the world. But now he's been teamed up with a man called Barnabas, and together they're getting sent off to go beyond the land of Israel and to go and speak to other people, because as Peter had realized in our service last week, the good news was not just for the Jews but also for the Gentiles. But sometimes you get communication problems when you do go outside of your comfort zone and you try to speak to people in a different culture, and that's what happens with Paul and Barnabas. They go to Lystra, and there they start talking and they heal someone, as they'll see, and then the crowd just really gets the wrong end of the stick, and we'll find out what happens. So rather than a reading, I have sourced a video this week from Superbook, and if all goes to plan, we'll be able to watch that. I think the thing did have subtitles, but the way the screen gets cut off, you can't see them. So you just have to keep your ears open, and hopefully you'll hear that.
God's love is for all people, Jews and Gentiles, young and old, the rich and the poor, the strong and the weak. Stand up straight on your feet. What is this noise?
The gods have come down to us in human form!
One spoke with the eloquence of Hermes!
The other was like Zeus himself!
Then we must sacrifice in their honor!
Going to your temple to sacrifice. They say you are Zeus, in human disguise.
Me? I am not their god, Zeus.
And they think you to be Hermes. We must put a stop to this. Friends, why are you doing this? We are merely human beings, just like you. Please give up all this foolishness. Turn to the living God, who made the sky, the earth, the sea, and everything in them. In times past, God let each nation go its own way, but he showed that he was there by the good things he did. God sends rain from heaven and makes your crops grow. He gives food to you and makes your hearts glad.
Are they calling the gods useless? Are they saying they are better than the gods?
Better get the children away from here.
Sacrifice!
Friends, listen to me. I bring you the message of the one true God.
Quickly, children.
Stone him!
Stone him!
thought you were dead. But I knew it could not be. We still have much to do, and I will not do it alone.
Always the son of encouragement. My friend, you are right. There is much work to be done.
Well, I know it's a cartoon, but it's always a bit different to see it rather than just hear it. So what happened to Lystra was that the people, and I don't know if you quite could hear that, but the people thought that Paul and Barnabas were Zeus and Hermes, which were like Zeus was the main god in the Greek pantheon of all the different gods they believed in, and Hermes was his messenger. Paul was Hermes because he was doing a lot of the talking, and Barnabas must have been a slightly quieter person, and they thought he was Zeus. Well, strange, strange story. I have a few pictures, and I'll nod Dave along as we'll go. Why on earth would you want to slaughter a bull to worship someone you admire? Very strange thing to happen. But fans do some weird things. I was reading up on the strange things that fans do, and apparently Harry Styles gets kiwis thrown at him at concerts because he has a song called Kiwi, and that's what people do. They like to throw things, and not because they disapprove of what he's singing, but just as a point of connection. But it's actually getting quite dangerous because he once nearly slipped on a squashy kiwi, so not a great idea. Now they've had to ask fans not to bring kiwis to concerts. There is a band called Glass Animals, and they had to tell people not to bring pineapples because they have a song that mentions pineapples. You can imagine that it would be even more problematic if pineapples were chucked at you. And then I read that Taylor Swift, I don't know if she has a song or an album that's something to do with turtles or she's involved with turtles, but anyway, she got sent a turtle with her face painted on it. I don't know. So yeah, turtles. And what's the next one? Oh yeah, Ariana Grande got a 42-pound pumpkin because it's, I don't know why that's a good thing, maybe for Halloween, but a bit big. And finally, and probably the most disturbing one, Dolly Parton, and that's all not mean so much to young people, but she has a song called Jolene, and one day she opened the door and there was an actual human baby left with the tag saying she's called Jolene. So that was more problematic, and of course the baby had to be given to social services. A really strange thing to give these things, but there is something maybe in human beings that want to give something special to the people that we admire, and there's maybe something in us humans that want to really devote our lives to something or someone. When we are small children, I'm talking probably, I don't know, under 7 or so, we look up to our parents like this. We probably worship them to some degree. We want their love and attention, and we also adore them. If you are ever at a playground with little children, you can probably hear some bragging about, you know, what their dads can do and whose dad's stronger or bigger or faster, or, you know, that phase. It does pass quite quickly as well. Also, at this point, whatever your parents say, you just accept as true, and that's it. But then you get to the next phase, and then your teacher is always right. And then no matter what your mom or your dad says, it's the teacher who is right. Then that also ends, and probably by the time you go to high school, it is the views of your peers, your friends, and the wider group that you care most about. And maybe at that stage you might become a fan of a band or I don't know, YouTuber is probably more relevant these days, or an individual pop star, or a sporting person. And we just really care a lot about what they say or do or how they look. And we might be called followers, if you like, because we're just really into them. When I was a young teenager, I was a big fan of New Kids on the Block. And again, this will probably not mean much to any of you here. It might have just missed out the relevant age category. But anyway, it was a boy band, typical boy band from America. And although I never went to a concert and didn't even have a CD player at the time, imagine that, it was still on cassettes, I bought a photo book with all these lovely, beautiful pictures of the five boys, and me and my friends each had our favourites, and we would kind of just, I don't know, stare at the pictures, I guess. And I wasn't really a very typical, silly girl, I guess, or particularly susceptible to this stuff. But yeah, even I got caught up for a little while. There must be a psychological explanation for these things. So the people that had seen Paul and Barnabas heal a man who couldn't walk thought they'd seen, they were gods. They thought they were Zeus and Hermes. They were so amazed at this miracle that they literally wanted to worship them. They wanted to give them something significant and costly, which was the bull and the garlands, was, you know, made it into a religious ceremony and a big party. And that's what they were going to do. Now that just seems like a crazy story to us. But apparently, which is what I found out in the past week as I was doing my research, in that area, so it's just, I guess, would be modern day Turkey, but that was all under the Greek kind of influence. There was a story going around there that was about 50 years old, that the Greek gods Zeus and Hermes had disguised themselves one time and had just, you know, come among the people, but nobody had welcomed them into their house. So they looked like normal people, but nobody wanted to give them food or a bed for the night. And so these gods, supposedly going around as human beings, hadn't been given any hospitality. And but one elderly poor couple that had let them in and had given out of their poverty what they had, and that obviously was a good thing. So then Hermes and Zeus had decided to bless this elderly couple and just send floods to destroy the homes of all the other people in the area. That was the story that the people still had somewhere in the back of their mind as they'd been told this. And that's clearly what they were worried, that if they missed them again, then maybe they would be punished and there would be more floods or fires or whatever. So this is why they respond with such seriousness and think that we'll not miss this opportunity again. That, I guess, explains why the misunderstanding happened. And when they saw Paul and Barnabas and this amazing healing, and probably Paul also preaching quite competently, because he was a good preacher, as we can tell from his letters and from the book of Acts, they thought there were Zeus and Hermes. And as I said, Zeus was like the main god for the top god for the Greeks, and Hermes was his messenger. Now, the Jewish people, I mean, obviously remember that Paul and Barnabas were Jews themselves, they were not allowed to make any images of God, no paintings, no statues, and they weren't allowed to even make images or statues of animals, even if they weren't going to worship them. They were not supposed to make these, try to copy what God had made. And they were often told in the Old Testament and, you know, by the prophets, etc., that it was ridiculous to make idols, because why would you make something with your own hands and then bow down before it as if it were your God? That was just crazy in the minds of the Jewish people. And it is, of course, in the Ten Commandments. So then when Paul and Barnabas have these crowds of people coming up to them with the bull and with the priests, and they want to worship them, they're horrified. And so they rip their clothes, which was a Jewish symbol of grief or mourning or repentance. They just really don't want this to happen. try desperately quickly to explain to the people Paul's preaching is on his feet, to try and say, look, this is not the gods, we're not gods, we're only human. You should be worshipping the God who made heaven and earth, who gives you rain, who's in charge of everything, and you don't need to bow down for us, you don't need to bow down for statues or other gods. And then if you read on, all this is in Acts chapter 14, it also then explains that some of the Jewish leaders in the town actually stir the people up to get Paul and Barnabas stoned, as we saw at the end, because they probably were jealous or they didn't want this Jesus story to spread. So reflecting on this story, I was struck by what the apostle said. We're only human. So that's really their theme for today. We're only human. And they meant, don't worship us. And it seems to me that's a good thing to remember when we're really into somebody, whether it's a YouTuber or a pop star or a sports person, or maybe even somebody we're totally in love with. People are not meant to be worshipped because they're only human. And sooner or later, if we've put all our hope and desire and everything into one person, in a human person, they will disappoint us. Because human beings can't fulfill all our needs and all our expectations. And of course, also for the person getting worship like that, it's not a healthy way to live. And often we see that stars or famous people actually end up living very unhappy lives because it's such a weird and disconnected life they end up living, where they're adulated and put on a pedestal that they can't be real, they can't go out the house without makeup on, or they can't just, you know, have an off day. They have to be perfect all the time and say the right thing all the time. It's not a very good way to be. Human beings are not meant to be worshipped, and we shouldn't worship them. We can respect them, we can encourage them, we can praise them, but they don't need to be worshipped. Maybe you want to say, well, I'm not like that, and don't worship anyone. I'm not a crazy fan, I'm just me. Well, that's good. But chances are we all have idols in our head, in our heart. It may be an ideal of who we want to be, or something that we want to reach, something that we want to obtain, like possessions, or we want to be good looking or clever or funny, or have a particular kind of career and be famous or have lots of friends. We have all these ideals in our head, and we probably want to have most of it or all of it, and it also becomes an idol. And this idol tells us that we're not worthy of love, or we don't have it all and do it all. And that in itself can make us very unhappy when we disappoint ourselves and we can't actually do or be that idol that we have in our head. And then we work a bit harder and another bit harder, or we feel miserable for not measuring up. And it's not just young people who can have idols or ideals in their head like that. It's people of all ages. I know I do it too. Sometimes I try to be superwoman and I think I need to cover all the grounds of life and be good in everything. And it's just not possible and it's not healthy, because I'm not God, I'm just human. So for all of us, it's important to remember we're only human and only God is God. We don't need to worship other people. They're only human. And we don't need to be worshipped by other people, because we're only human. And only God is God, and he's the one who won't let us down or disappoint us, and is worthy of worship. Amen. We're going to sing. If you're up for it, I would invite you to stand and sing along, As the Deer Pants for Water, hymn 550.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear God, you are the creator of the universe and you've made me. I'm only human and that is okay. Don't have to be everything and do everything and always be in control. That is your job. Help me to leave my idols and ideals behind. I am only human and you are God. We give thanks for the inspiring example and talents of other people. Help me to remember that no matter how great or fabulous they are only human. They are not gods and I should not worship them. They don't need this. They are only human. You alone are worthy of our adoration and our worship. Our best gifts should be reserved for you, our dreams and hopes pinned on you. Help us to get to know you better, personally. Make us aware of your presence in our lives. Help us to worship and honor you better. May we all live lives of sacrifice to you. We pray for young people who are struggling with expectations others put on them and that they put on themselves. May they know they are unique, loved, and talented, each in their own way. That you have made them, and so therefore they are not rubbish because you do not make rubbish. We pray for people of all ages who pin their hopes on the wrong people or the wrong things. We get disappointed time after time, or we spend all their energy on work or status, security or whatever, but cannot see how to live life in all its fullness. We pray for people who are sick, longing for healing and wholeness. We pray for the doctors and nurses in the NHS, many of whom are so tired after the past year and a half. And we pray for the people who are faced with long, long waits for treatment. We pray for Leslie and her family as they wait further to see what treatment might be possible. And we pray for Peter and his family as they prepare for Caroline's funeral on Friday. We pray for those who are close to death and those who love them. We pray for those who are filled with sadness because someone has died. In all these things, we are reminded that we are only human and cannot fix this world ourselves. We pray for your new heaven and new earth to come, for this earth to be renewed and all things made whole and well. For Jesus to return and wipe away all the tears and do away with evil and pain. In the meantime, help us to do for one another what we can, even though we're only human. In the silence, we pray our own prayers. God, we know and thank you that you hear our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen. Our final hymn this morning is hymn 458, At the Name of Jesus. And after that, please remain standing for the blessing.
Thank you.
knowing you are only human and God is God. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and those you love now and forevermore.